So, yes, I am Koenraad Elst. I am a doctor of Oriental Philology and History. That's what it's called officially, better known as an Orientalist. So some people have taken over all this Edward Said's slander against Orientalists. Well, I can tell you I'm proud to be an Orientalist. So we're going to talk about the state of the art in the so-called Aryan debate, a topic which I have the impression will be very new to you. So a historical survey, we can start at the beginning. It was a British Jesuit whose name I forget, a British Jesuit, Stephen something, in the 16th century, he expressed the very first suspicion that Sanskrit might be related to the European languages, but nothing much came of it. A few more, but so the first real elaboration of this kinship was done in a paper sent to the Academy in Paris in 1767 by the French Jesuit Gaston Laurent Cœurdoux, working in South India. He spoke Telugu, Sanskrit, as well as French. And so in that he showed the kinship of Latin and Greek with Sanskrit. If you look for ulterior motives, well, no, I don't think there were any ulterior motives. He was just a great scholar. Nevertheless, he did have his opinions, and they're not always nice. Like he expressed his joy when a Hindu temple was destroyed. Okay, so Sanskrit had a key role in this discovery. You see, so many millions of people had known both Latin and Greek and had not remarked the kinship between the two. And now, thanks to Sanskrit, it all became clear. So many people at that time assumed that Sanskrit was the mother of all the related languages, which is most of the European languages. Like you can see here, you see all the languages in color here. The blue languages are Indo-Iranian, the green are Slavic, in yellow is Greek, in light green is Albanian, and in other kind of light green, Baltic, then in red, Germanic, and in brown, the Romance languages. I can't see any of the Celtic languages. It's only like the coast of Ireland and Wales and Brittany. Okay, so that family, people thought that all those languages were daughters of Sanskrit, though it soon became clear that even Sanskrit could not be the ancestors of the others. William Jones, whose picture you see here, of course, this page should have carried a picture of Gaston Laurent Cœurdoux, but I haven't been able to find one. And so I'm afraid that now this picture is going to confirm Indians in the wrong idea that the whole thing was started by William Jones. Anyway, he made it known in India. You see, he's a pioneer in India. And so he didn't believe that Sanskrit was the origin. In his paper, he already writes, you see, all these languages, including Sanskrit, may have descended from a language that has probably disappeared. Most at the time assume India to be the homeland. The main competitor for this status was Armenia. Because of the Bible, the Ark of Noah lands in Armenia on Mount Ararat. You see, on Mount Ararat, you have a rock formation in the shape of a boat. So that's where the idea came from. So Noah landed there, and he had three sons and three daughters-in-law. And so one of his sons is Japheth. And the Indo-Europeans were thought to be the descendants of Japheth. Okay, so the idea of India as the homeland, nowadays known as the Out of India theory, was started not by Hindu fanatics, but by the top, by the cream of the European intellectuals in the late 18th century. The term out of India theory, however, was coined by Edwin Bryant, an American scholar, in 1997. The picture in the corner below is of Japheth. Yeah, that's, you know, they were early with photography. So the out of India theory was the standard version of the genesis story of Indo-European. You have a French intellectual, French freethinker, Voltaire. He was probably the first to publicize the paper sent in by Gaston Laurent Curdeau. And he at once instrumentalizes it ideologically. He was on a personal crusade against Christianity. And so he said, oh, look, you see, all the good things in European culture actually came from the banks of the Ganga. Meaning, in his case, and not from the Bible. Then other people like Immanuel Kant, like Johann Herder, Jules Michelet, also joined in. Friedrich Schlegel, par excellence, he wrote in 1808 a book called Language and Wisdom of the Indians, in which he greatly praises India. So there was a tendency of Indomania at the time. I mean, some people in India say, oh no, it was also disparaging, and so on. It's exactly the contrary. The term Aryan is introduced by the same Friedrich Schlegel. The term Aryan was already used in Europe, namely by the French Orientalist, or actually the father of Orientalism, Abraham Hyacinthe Anquetil du Perron. But he used it in the sense of Indo-Iranian, because only in the Vedas and in the Avesta people call themselves Arya. Elsewhere, you see, the other branches of Indo-European don't do that, except for Hittite, but that hadn't been discovered yet. So they think that the Urheimat was India, and that from there people had emigrated. So that lasted for about 60 years. Then you had in 1834 August Schlegel, who proposes the Caucasus Mountains as the homeland. You see, here and there, there were some people who dissented from the dominant Indian homeland theory. And I think here you get the shift, the moment when the tide turns, when the scales are tipped. So more and more people start doubting that India was it. At any rate, the linguists have already found out that Sanskrit was not the same as Proto-Indo-European. Proto-Indo-European is the putative mother of all the branches, and it has to be painstakingly reconstructed. But at least this much they were already sure of: it was not the same as Sanskrit. You know, on the one hand, Sanskrit is ancient. For example, in Latin and Greek, you have a singular and a plural, but no dual, which you do have in Sanskrit. And you could say, but maybe in Sanskrit they had invented the dual. No, because in Latin and Greek, you still find some remains, some relics of the dual. So clearly they had it before. Or, for instance, in Sanskrit you have 8 cases of the noun, in Latin only 6, in Greek only 5, in German only 4, and in English none at all. So there you could see, yes, Sanskrit is older, but at the same time it's not the language of origin. For example, you have the shift in the pronunciation of the consonants, like gegoma. Well, gegoma should be the original form that corresponds with the same forms in the European branches. And so in Sanskrit, that becomes jagama. I went. So it comes from gegoma. So the vowels have changed. A and O have both become A. And before A, the G changes pronunciation to J. So this becomes jagama. Then the vowels change jagama. But so the two vowels are the same, jaga, and yet the consonants get a different treatment. Why? Because originally the vowels were different. And so the G before O does not change, whereas the G before O does change. And this is a very normal pattern. You find this in very many languages, that G changes to J, or that G changes to Ch. Like, for instance, in modern English, you have many of these words, which has originally been vika, a witch, I mean, a magician woman, or witch in the sense of, you know, which of the two are you choosing? You know, in the related language Dutch, this is welk, and so on. I mean, in Swedish and so on, you have all these changes. Like in Swedish, you write the name of the city Norrköping, but you pronounce Norrköping, and so on. So, I mean, this is a very common, or in Chinese, for instance, Peking is now pronounced Beijing. So, you see, this has happened in Sanskrit too, but so thereby you can see that between the languages of origin and Sanskrit, already a certain time has passed in which certain changes have taken place. So it was deduced from that India was not the homeland. Now this is in fact not a very logical reasoning, because languages can change all while staying in the same place. In fact, that's what they do most of the time. But okay, I can think that, but at the time, this idea won the day that the distance between Proto-Indo-European and Sanskrit was a certain magnitude linguistically. Therefore, geographically, the distance between the homeland and India also had to be more than zero. So if the homeland was outside India, whether in the Caucasus or anywhere else, but outside India, then they could only have gotten into India by invading. So that's why these theories are, from the Indian viewpoint, called the Aryan invasion theory. So other homelands have also been proposed over the years, like Northern Europe, Anatolia, Belarus, and even Atlantis. Just like the Dravidianists have as their homeland Lemuria, the sunken continent. Ultimately, the Caucasus area has won through. So it started with Armenia on the south of the Caucasus Mountains. Nowadays, you have just north of the Caucasian Mountains, you have a part of Russia and Ukraine. And in 1926, it was Gordon Childie from Australia who very explicitly made that choice, and that choice has remained dominant till today. However, the out-of-India believers did not give up like that. And so several European intellectuals who happened to be teachers of Sanskrit in India, that existed, they defended the out-of-India theory. You see, there's always the number one role is taken by Europeans staying in India. You see, for Indians, this was a completely foreign affair. They had never had any reason to think that their ancestors came from anywhere else. So this was a business of Europeans, but especially of Europeans living in India. So Kurdu had been living in India. William Jones was living in India. here Mount Stuart Elphinstone was living in India. He had been the governor of Bombay Presidency, so he was, let's say, a colonialist par excellence. And so after retirement, he wrote a book called The History of India. And in that he says, it is contrary to their foreign origin that neither in the Code of Manu, nor I believe in the Vedas, is there any allusion to a prior residence. That's an argument that is still used till today. You, whatever you look for in the books, you won't find any indication of a prior residence elsewhere. Some people have been frantically looking for it. And so this is where you get the famous built down verse of Michael Witzel. The built down man, for those who don't know, in the history of paleontology, when they researched human fossils to know more about, you see, the earlier types of human being, the Piltdown Man was a forgery that, you see, was a bit Neanderthal and a bit modern man. And so this was just to push the theory that there was some transition between the two, and that turned out to be fake. Now here also, people have tried to find a halfway position between the Aryan invasion theory and the Vedic testimony. So you see, Witzel proposed that a certain verse about Amu and Amavasu, of which the one stays in India and the one goes out, that this actually refers to the Aryan invasion, that one of the two comes into India and the other not so much. But you see, if you read the phrase in Sanskrit, it is completely obvious that this does not refer to any foreign origin, as I myself have shown. It was the additional thesis to my doctoral dissertation. You know, I mean, traditionally you have to, you know, build a real strong new theory, but then you also have to comment on a few other topics just to broaden your horizon. And so it is in that status, in that capacity, that I took the trouble of analyzing this proposal by Witzel. Then Elphinstone says, the question therefore is still open. There is no reason whatever for thinking that the Hindus ever inhabited any country but their presence. Their present, sorry. Now, why is it that these Europeans living in India behave so differently from the Europeans living in Europe? You see, again, there are all kinds of conspiracy theories in India. No, in this case, not all kinds of. There's really only one conspiracy theory in this case, namely, they're all vicious, ugly, racist colonialists, and that's why they invent all this, you know, against India. No. But you see, there were a number of factors that conditioned people who were not exposed to Indian reality to greatly underestimate India. So look here on this map. This is a map in the Mercator projection. You see, if you have to depict a curved surface on a flat paper, then you have to make a compromise. So either you maintain the distances, but then the angles aren't correct, or if you make a map that has to be used by navigators at sea, you have to make sure that the angles are correct, but then the distances won't be correct. So that's what happens here. On this map, you can see, for instance, that the whole of the Indian subcontinent is smaller than Scandinavia, whereas in reality, the Indian subcontinent is bigger than the European subcontinent. So, you see, that's why it became easy for people to neglect India, to think nothing much about India. So India was gravely underestimated, and the people who were living in India, they were far more aware of the importance and the magnitude of India. Now, in spite of Elphinstone's brave attempt, he couldn't save the out of India theory. And so in the mid-19th century, it really gets a burial with two important nails in its coffin. One is the rise of linguistic paleontology. The first name I can associate it with that is the Swiss scholar Adolf Pichte. So he argues that in an old language, the vocabulary of that language will indicate in what environment those people were living. Like, for example, you can know that the Proto-Indo-Europeans lived in a society that had wagon technology. There are six words for cart, for wheel, for axle, six words in wagon technology that exist in all the branches of Indo-European. So they must have existed in Proto-Indo-European. And that was not the case in other languages existing at that time. So this was distinctive for Proto-Indo-European that they had wagon technology. And so this you can deduce from their vocabulary. Now, another thing you could deduce was their environment. So, an argument that was used was the beech argument. The beech tree, or fagus in Latin, is a Western European tree. Now, in a few Western languages, in the Romance and Germanic languages especially, this name occurred. And the relation between the Romance and the Germanic version was regular, as if this was an Indo-European word. So it was decided, therefore, Proto-Indo-European must have been in West Europe. Then it indicated a cold territory. It had the birch tree, which in India also exists in Kashmir. The wolf and the bear. Now, all these species exist in India, as a matter of fact, because a hot climate country nevertheless has islands of cold climate. And whereas the other way around is not correct, you have no islands of tropical climate in Europe. But so anyway, at that time, people thought, oh yeah, you see, because of these cold climate animals, must have been in a cold climate, so India is out of the question. This technique is also used now in an ongoing debate among Indo-Europeanists, whether the Proto-Indo-Europeans knew agriculture, because the agricultural vocabulary, well, paints a rather complex picture. So this is going to be my next paper, Tanya, about the linguistic paleontology of the agricultural terminology. So I'll just give a quick impression. So some people say, oh yes, in the homeland they knew agriculture, and then when going through Russia, they lost agriculture, and when they came in India, they had to start from zero, and they had to take new words for agriculture, and often they were borrowed from the local native languages. Whereas you could just as well argue the other way around. A Proto-Indo-European had some terms for agriculture, because in India there are plenty of it. Then when they trekked through Russia for a few generations, they lost the knowledge of most of agriculture. And then when they came in Europe, they had to borrow new words for those same things that they had known in India. So this is a bit complicated. You know, another argument against linguistic paleontology is that when people leave an area, they will lose that word or they will give a new meaning to the same word. For example, and here I come to the latest phase of linguistic paleontology, namely Shrikant Talageri's reply, that, for example, the elephant, this word elephant, is also attested in the original vocabulary. And here you see there are no islands of cold climate in Europe where they also have elephants, the way that in India they have bears and wolves. So, you see, according to the rules of linguistic paleontology, the homeland has to be India, because that's the only country in the entire Indo-European expanse that has elephants. Same for lion, same for ape, same for leopard. When human beings moved to Central Asia, they lost sight of the elephant, but they kept the word for the next big animal that they met, namely the camel. And so you have a Gothic word, urbandus, that is related to elephant, but that has a different meaning. Right? And so those are all the complications that make linguistic paleontology a bit tricky. And so linguistic paleontology now among the scholars has a bit of a bad name, though in the background is still very much being used. Anyway, so at that time, the effect was that the out of India theory seemed to become unviable. Then the second factor is the rise of racial thought. So here you have a few big names that are big names in history books, not in Indo-European linguistics, but they did influence the whole intellectual climate, and this way they influenced Indo-European research as well. Like, for instance, the British Prime Minister, Benjamin Disraeli, said that race is the key to all of history. You see, these were the decades after Charles Darwin's book, The Origin of Species. And so race was all the craze, and you see, everybody started reinterpreting everything in terms of race. This also happened with the first translations of the Rig Veda that were being published at the time. So, there are a number of historical passages in the Rig Veda that were interpreted as battles pitting the white invaders against the dark aboriginals. So, white invaders versus dark natives. Now, Friedrich Max Müller, who of course has a bad name in India, nevertheless, he did some good things too. Like, for instance, he had a very big name because he was the editor of the Sacred Books of the East. It was a series of translations of all the sacred books of the East, not only of India, also of China and Persia and so on. And that was a bit of a cultural revolution, because suddenly all the philosophers and all the artists got access to the fabled wisdom of the Orient. So you see, that was strongly associated with the name Max Müller. So he was not just anyone. And here also he had a very correct contribution to the debate. He was against the use of Aryan in terms of the Aryan race. You see, the Aryan race at the time were people who were dolichocephalic. You know, they were tall and white, and dolichocephalic, which means long-skulled and long-nosed. And a true Aryan, and that's why I am not a true Aryan, also has a knob on his back head. Me, I have a flat back head. So I don't count as an Aryan. But some of you perhaps do. No, brachycephal is something else. No, brachycephal means that you have a broad skull. Like, for instance, in 1938, Heinrich Himmler of the Nazi regime sent an expedition to Tibet because he was going to see if the Aryan invaders coming from Europe and going to the East had remained, you know, in existence in some valley in Tibet. But he was very disappointed. Because, you see, I mean, some, you know, there are many books that mention this expedition, but they never mention the outcome. You see, Himmler was very disappointed because the Tibetans were not Aryans. Of course, they, on their temple walls, they had all these swastikas. Yes, but nevertheless, they were not good Aryans because they are the most broad-skulled people in the world. So, no. Anyway, so Friedrich Max Müller was against this whole discourse. He said, you see, Aryan, when I say Aryan, I only use it in a linguistic sense, Indo-European. And, you know, it's not an Aryan race. To speak about an Aryan race is as ridiculous as speaking about a dolichocephalic grammar. Nevertheless, that didn't carry the day, and so race was all over. For example, in the Rig Veda, there are a number of these battles where the enemy is described as black. So this is the perfect illustration, I would say. And so they're fighting the blacks, you know, while they're invading. Now, in reality, black is a fairly common designation for the enemy. In the Second World War, in my own country and in France and so on, someone who collaborated with the Nazi occupiers was called a black. And someone who fought against them was called a white. And in India, for instance, the British security reports about Subhash Chandra Bose systematically call him a black. Now here this gets systematically interpreted as skin color. Similarly, in the word Varna, which means the four classes of society, this word Varna happens to also mean color. It means quality, it means a spectrum of qualities, like you have a spectrum of sounds called the Varnamala. But so it's also the color spectrum. So there you have the Varnas of the different colors. If you speak about Triguna, you see there are three different qualities, but they're characterized, they're recognizable by their symbol colors, white, red, and black. Now, you see, this was totally denied, and this was simply interpreted as a form of racial apartheid. So the Varna system, the caste system, was seen as people being in racial groups, like you had in the United States a century ago, where people were divided by skin color. This was refuted in 1999 by Hans Heinrich Hock, the man in the picture, one of the topmost Indo-Europeanists. And so he shows that, you see, black has a few different usages, but none, you know, pertaining to skin color. The very first, to my knowledge, deracialized Rig Veda translation is the last one from 2014 by Stephanie Jamieson and Noel Brereton. There they emphasize, they also put it in footnote, that black does not mean skin color. But back then, you have, for example, the Battle of the Ten Kings, which is the most important event in the Rig Veda. It describes the defeat of the Anavas, who are the ancestors of the Iranians, and also the Greeks, Armenians, Albanians, but especially the Iranians. All the names that they have are Iranian. The kings have Iranian names, the tribes have Iranian names. And their religion is also described, and it is recognizably Zoroastrianism. Anyway, you see, and I don't understand how anybody could have missed this, because it's totally obvious that the enemies are Iranians. And yet, they have always interpreted them as being the black aboriginals. Now, it is described twice, in fact, that the Vedic people are coming from the east and the enemies are coming from the west, which is exactly the opposite of what you would get in an Aryan invasion scenario. Anyway, they all took that in stride. And they translated Asikni Jana, which is said about the enemy, as the black tribe. Now, in reality, the Asikni means the black one, namely the black river. And it means the Chenab, which is a river in West Punjab. And so that's a river that lies to the west of the Parushni or the Ravi, which is the stream on the banks of which King Sudas of the Vedic tribe is waging war against the ten kings. So they come from the Black River. They are the Asikni Jana, you know, the guys from the Black River. It also so happens that their own Vedic priest, Vasishta, is described as Shvitnya, which is related to Shweta, the word for white, and it means white clad. But it is often translated as white complexioned. So, you know, it says literally, these are the whites against the blacks. So it becomes difficult to defend the idea of an out of India theory when the Vedic people themselves say, ah, but we are white invaders fighting the blacks. You know, if that's how you translate it. So today, nobody's going to take up this, the responsibility for such a translation. Nevertheless, it remains very influential. You know, suppose you're interested in the Veda, and nowadays, of course, you Google, and you find one English translation on Google, namely, one for free. You can also get a Kindle edition of the 2014 translation, but then you have to pay $10 or something. So for free, you can get the translation of Ralph Griffith, which is 150 years old, which has all the, you know, all the racist elements in it, and which says explicitly in footnote that dark refers to the dark aboriginals. So then now we have to do a little intermezzo about the politicized version of the Aryan invasion theory. The British colonialists did not invent this theory, but once it was there, they took it and used it. And so they said, well, you see, this history proves that the British invasion is merely a repetition of the Aryan invasion, which is the invasion that has brought the Hindus, or certainly the upper caste Hindus, into India. So, as Churchill said, we British have as much right to be in India as anyone there, except perhaps the depressed classes that are the native stock. But then the other part of the colonial theory is, of course, that the colonialists are bringing good governance, and so these native stock are too primitive and too barbaric. They can't provide good governance. So everybody in India should be happy that the white invaders come there all the way from England, you see, through all these dangers and deprivations, or they come all the way to provide you with good governance. Shouldn't you be grateful? All right. So Viceroy Lord Curzon called history, including the Aryan invasion theory, the furniture of empire. Then you have the National Socialists. The main race ideologue among the Nazis was Hans Günther, and he very much promoted the Aryan invasion theory, and he thought it was the perfect illustration of the Nazi worldview. First, you have the dynamic Aryans, that's us, who defeat the aboriginals. Because, of course, the Aryans are more skillful, more dynamic, and so on. And you are indolent. And okay. Then, wisely, the invaders impose the caste system, which is, of course, a racial apartheid system, in order to preserve their racial purity. If only they had stayed true to their wise decision. But unfortunately, you see, all these charming native ladies, they attracted a certain, what shall I say, pull on the Aryan invaders. And so they mixed anyway. Mixed children were born. And so they lost their racial purity. They degenerated. But fortunately for them, they were saved. Because even though they had lost their racial purity, they had still cousins back in England who had preserved their racial purity. So they were superior. They came all the way to India. In fact, it's Max Müller who said that, you see, it is like providence that has brought the old cousins back together. And so the English come there and they come, you know, to provide you good governance. I mean, look at the railway system. You could never have built that. Fortunately, you had the British who built it. Yes, the Westminster democracy. I mean, come on. Why do you have all these buildings, locks up high and so on? Thanks to the British. They gave that to you generously. So, you see, to sum up, the most politicized historical theory ever so far that we know of is the Aryan invasion theory. And this cannot be better illustrated than with Adolf Hitler. You see, some people think that the Out of India theory is the product of the ugly, vicious, despicable Hindu fanatics, and that they are like the Nazis, because the Nazis too wanted to claim the Aryan homeland for themselves. Well, that's actually not true. There were some Germans who thought that the homeland was in Northern Europe, though they weren't sure. Probably it was in Scandinavia. But there is one, even after the war, Lothar Kilian, he said it was in the North German, North Polish plain. That was the homeland. But that's also already a bygone theory. But so most of the Germans were quite happy to accept that it was in Eastern Europe that the land of origin lay. Then, as for India, they were very emphatic about the invasion into India, because that was precisely, as I just explained, the illustration of the Nazi worldview. So Hitler spoke very rarely about the Hindus. It didn't interest him too much. It's just always negative. He has no good word to say about Hindus. And so the most important thing was his racial interpretation of the Aryan invasion theory. And I quote, "We know that the Hindus in India are a people mixed from the lofty Aryan immigrants and the dark black aboriginal population, and that this people is bearing the consequences today. For it is also a slave people of a race that almost seems like a second Jewry." And you see, in Hitler's mouth, being compared with the Jews was not meant as a compliment. Nowadays, many scholars are very squeamish and they don't want to have this rough invasion scenario. So they insist, no, not invasion. We don't teach the invasion. No. It's immigration. The Aryan immigration theory. Well, you see, even there they have a role model in Adolf Hitler, who, in the quote that I just gave, prefers the word immigrant to the word invader. Okay, now back to the real thing. So, another element in this Aryan invasion theory is, when did it happen? Max Müller, with all his influence, estimated that the invasion took place in 1500 BC and that the Rig Veda was written around 1200 BC. Now, you see, this came in the newspapers and so on, and this became common knowledge and everybody accepted it. It was the great Max Müller who had said so. However, a few colleagues of his, fellow Orientalists, disagreed. They said, well, this is not based on anything. You know, why are you saying this? And his own pupil, Moritz Winternitz, said, you see, this can't be. You can't cram the entire philosophical evolution between the early Vedas and the Buddha into a few centuries. The Rig Veda must be like the third millennium BC. And so it is much less well known that Max Müller also retracted his estimate. He admitted, well, yeah, now you come to mention it. Yes, it's only a guess. I don't know. And then he became a bit gloomy, and he threw his hands up in the air, and he said, well, we'll never know. No power on earth will be able to determine if it was 1,000 or 2,000 or 3,000. You see, I think that was unnecessarily pessimistic. But it's a very important issue. You see, this 1500 BC has become a standard that everybody accepts. And so when David Reich came with his genetic findings of an influx into India from the northwest in about 1700 BC, everybody, you see, in India, people like Tony Joseph and Kancha Ilaya and so on, they applauded. Oh yeah, this finally proves the Aryan invasion. Well, it does no such thing. It only proves the Aryan invasion if that took place around that time. And so I have nothing against David Reich's findings. You see, as far as I'm concerned, why not an influx of people in 1700 BC? There have been so many. The Scythians have come in, what is it, maybe 900 BC or so. And the Huns and the Greeks and the Turks and the Kushans, they all have come. They all have left their genes in India, but not their language. In fact, they have not even kept their own language, let alone impose it upon the natives. So somehow these Aryans behave differently, apparently. But the thing is that we don't know if they were Aryans. We have no indication at all that they spoke Sanskrit or anything related. And indeed, we know very sure that they didn't. Or maybe they also spoke Sanskrit, who knows? But at any rate, they were too late to bring Sanskrit into India. Why? Well, because Sanskrit was already here in India. And so, you see, the Rig Veda goes back to beyond 3000 BC. In fact, I think I'm in agreement here with Jijit. So, you see, everybody who takes a serious look at this knows that the Rig Veda is mostly from the 3rd millennium BC. Maybe I can, you know, take a little sidestep and explain this. So you have a number of literary indications of astronomical positions. Now, in astronomy, you have a very big clock or a big hand on the clock that goes very slowly. This is the precession cycle. This takes 25,772 years. Or about 71 years for 1 degree. And if a star is located on one of the solstices or equinoxes, okay, then you know at what time this was. So, for example, in the two of the Brahmanas, as well as in the Yajurveda, it is said that Magha, or the star Regulus, passes the solstice. Now, we know when this happened. This was in the 23rd century BC. So, the Rig Veda was already pretty much complete by then. The Atharva Veda was being written. The Brahmanas were being written. And it was not even 2000 BC yet, let alone the Aryan invasion in 1500 BC. Then you have two works of astronomy and manuals that teach you observational astrology, so astronomy. So you have to look at the stars to see where they are and so on. It cannot possibly be some reminiscence of some ancestor. No, no, this is the stars like they are today. And so in the Vedanga Jyotisha, and exactly the same thing in another work that has only recently been reconstructed, the Parashara Tantra, translated by R.N. Iyengar. In two different ways, these books date themselves, namely by mentioning which star is on the equinox or on the solstice, And in both cases, it is the 14th century BC. Now, these books are absolutely post-Vedic. They presuppose that the Vedas are a complete corpus. So they are being written at the time when, according to Max Müller, they have yet to start writing the Veda, right? So, or the same Iyengar, I heard him talk a week ago in Gandhinagar, and he gave also the example of Shishumara, that is the constellation Draco, the dragon, of which the main star is Tuban, which is the tail end of the dragon. And so that was the pole star in about 2700 BC. Now that is mentioned in the Rig Veda as a pole star. And then in later works, like in the Maitri Upanishad, you get a description of, oh, the pole star isn't where it should be. The pole star is moving away from the pole. So that's, you know, that's centuries later. And it's also clear when you read it that they don't understand the phenomenon. You see, this writer is busy about, yeah, nothing is anymore as it should be. You know, the youths aren't polite to old people anymore, and so on, or whichever example he gives. The usual complaint of people that, you know, the world is falling apart. And so one example he gives is this star that doesn't behave as it should be, or at least as it used to. And so that is not because the star is misbehaving, no. The star is precisely following its own regular movement, but it is that movement that takes it away from the pole. Okay? So that was a text written in 1500 or so BC. Anyway, but so you see this star Tuban as pole star points to an age in the third millennium BC. You see, totally incompatible with Max Müller's dating. Then the Kaushitaki Brahmana gives also the disposition of Regulus. And so that points to the 23rd century BC. Now, this is mentioned in an Indological book by Keith and MacDonald, the Vedic Index, which probably every Indologist has had to read in his student days. And so there you see they admit the facts. And then the next day says, yeah, this probably points to a position in 800 to 600 BC. So just a cavalier attitude, they just change the data 15 centuries. I mean, you see, I don't know if there's any evil intention behind this, but the result at any rate is very unscientific. And so you see, there is no astronomical information at all that supports the Aryan invasion chronology. They all very convergently point to a higher chronology with the Rig Veda or around 3000 BC. And the later Vedas around 2000 BC. So you see, The Max Müller's guess is demonstrably wrong. And yet, you see, it still persists. I remember some online discussion with Professor Michael Witzel, where he defends this date. He says, yes, it is true that Max Müller had no leg to stand on when he made that guess, but he just happened to be right. Now, the Out of India theory comes back to life in 1982, thanks to K.D. Setna. He's a Parsi. He has two complicated first names that I don't know. K.D. Setna was the secretary of Sri Aurobindo. And so this is more than 30 years after the death of Sri Aurobindo, who was already an old man. He lived till his 107 or something. And so he wrote this book, Karpasa. Karpasa means cotton in Sanskrit. And there he argues that cotton is not mentioned in the Rig Veda, whereas archaeologically it is found that it was present in the Harappan cities. These cities start in about 2600 BC, so he concludes that the Rig Veda is older than 2600. And so here he is a bit more ambitious than even Shrikant Talageri, who says, yes, you see, the early Vedas are older, but then, you see, they last, he says, until maybe 1500 BC, Chichitir says until 1900 BC, but at any rate overlapping with the urban period of Harappa. Then in 1984, there's an American archaeologist, James Sheffer, who also rejects the Aryan invasion scenario because as an archaeologist, he has not found any proof for it. Mind you, what Alexander Semenenko and our Premendra Priyadarshi have done, namely show elements pointing to migration from India into Central Asia. You see, that's a few, let's say, amateurs who have found this, whereas here, a whole army of archaeologists already for 100 years is looking for the proof of the Aryan invasion into India, and they still haven't found anything. So you see, some archaeologists start drawing conclusions from that. And indeed, many Indian archaeologists who work, you know, here on their home turf already had that impression, but because of the prestige of the British founders of the Archaeological Survey of India, you know, didn't dare to speak up. So from then on, they start speaking up. And even Bibi Lal, who had first been cited as archaeological support for the Aryan invasion, says, well, I used to go with the Aryan invasion theory because that was the official paradigm, and I sort of force-fitted my findings into that paradigm. But actually, my data don't prove that paradigm. You see, I only adapt them to that paradigm, but they might just as well fit in another paradigm. And so he ended up strongly advocating the out-of-India theory. And you see, he said it is not true that the Vedic culture has replaced the Harappan culture. On the contrary, the Vedic and Harappan culture are just two sides of the same coin. Indeed, you see, this position is sometimes known as David Frawley's paradox. And actually, it goes back farther. R.C. Majumdar, in his famous history of the Indian people, already makes that remark, that it's very strange that here you have a culture that is archaeologically attested, and there you have a literary testimony of a culture, and somehow nobody brings these two together. Then a number of other scholars follow, not perhaps the greatest specialists, but at any rate a number of them, including Westerners like Klaus Klostermeyer and Georg Feuerstein. The Indian Marxist Bhagwan Singh comes out with a book, The Vedic Harappans, which again argues at length that the Harappan artifacts and those described in the Vedas match. Linguistic professor Satya Swarup Mishra also gives some linguistic arguments. Like he says, you see, all the things that you would find strange from an Aryan invasion viewpoint about the converse scenario of, you know, people leaving India, actually that all comes true in the case of the gypsies. Like, for example, it is said that all the Western branches do not have retroflex sounds. Like in India, for instance, shad, and it's like shadyantra. So they are sho and their do are retroflex. Now people say, ah yeah, you see, they must have acquired these retroflex sounds under influence of Dravidian once they invaded India. Now, in fact, there are arguments against these sounds being Dravidian. Probably the Dravidian languages themselves have taken them over. But what Satya Swarup Mishra shows is that upon leaving India, the Gypsy languages lost these sounds. And as Shrikant Talageri remarks, you can even see it here within one generation. You see Indians who move to America, when they come visit, you know, home 20 years later, those sounds have already eroded considerably, because in American usage they don't appear. Then you have Sanskrit professor Nicholas Kazanas. He used to teach the Aryan invasion theory. In fact, most people who espouse the out-of-India theory today, myself included, used to believe in the Aryan invasion theory. They are converts. So one of these converts is Nicholas Kazanas, a professor of Sanskrit in Athens, and he gave more linguistic arguments. Like, for instance, he says that the other languages are markedly younger and more evolved and having lost more that has been preserved in Sanskrit. For example, all the other languages have a word for name. That's in fact a very common word. All the languages have it, nam. And Sanskrit also has it. But the difference is, in Sanskrit, it is actually a derivative of a verbal root, namami, I greet. So the form of address with which you greet someone is his name. And so in the other languages, you have a word name, and that's just, you know, a naked presence in the lexicon that's not linked with other words, whereas in Sanskrit, it is part of a whole family of words. Or like, for example, the word pater. Among linguists, there is a lot of discussion about the meaning of this ter in Bharatar, matar, and so on. So this French professor Pinot argues convincingly that this should not be taken to be a nomen agentis, a name of the acting person. Like, for instance, in worker, you have this suffix er that indicates the person who does something. So he argues that this is not the meaning of this ter in pater. Nevertheless, the form pa, now that is important, because that clearly is the same word as in the Sanskrit root pa, meaning to protect, like in nirpa, the king is the protector of men. Or in gopala. And so that's the cow protector, and so on. Kazana says, you see, in Sanskrit, this word still is part of a family of words, whereas in other languages, the word father stands on its own. It's not some derivative of some verb or something, it's just the word for father and nothing else. Now, all of us, those that I've just mentioned, they saw that there was something wrong with the Aryan invasion theory, but they had no counter theory. And so this is the great merit of Shrikant Talageri. You see, a few years from now, this whole debate will be passed. And names like Kazanas and Satya Swarup Mishra and Jim Sheffer and Koenraad Elst and so on will all fade into oblivion. But one name that is absolutely going to be preserved is Shrikant Talageri. You see, after all, he did it. And so his first book in 1993, that was interesting, but that was still a bit confused. You see, as he himself admits, it was based on the Puranas, and their version of history is very garbled, very distorted. Whereas in the second book, he bases himself on the data that are given in the Rig Veda itself. And there he has a very consistent and very convincing story that happens to yield an emigration from India. So that's his book, Rig Veda, a Historical Analysis, and the sequel in 2008, The Rig Veda and the Avesta, the Final Evidence. So those, you see, if you want to be with it, those you really have to read. Now, I'm not speaking in favor of the booksellers, so maybe they won't like it if I say, but actually, just online, totally for free, you can find most of these ideas. You know, he keeps a blog where he regularly updates his findings, so you can get a totally up-to-date version for free. Like, one of the things he finds there is an east-to-west gradient. You find the oldest books of the Rig Veda know of the Ganga, know of the Saraswati, and so on. It's only in the later books that they start moving west, they discover the Indus, then they discover the Kabul River, and so on, up to the Amu Darya in the north of Afghanistan. Then he shows that the narrative also contains references to the middle and the last phase of the emigration from India. The first phase must be the emigration of the Hittites. That's out of sight. We don't have any testimony of that. Or at least to the extent that we understand now, maybe it'll show up. But so the first one that we can recognize is about the emigration of the Druhyus. And this happens before the Veda actually starts. You see, in the Rig Veda, there are a number of reminiscences from the past. Like as we speak about the Second World War or Shivaji or so. So none of us has seen it, but it's sufficiently present in the collective memory that we have a fair idea. So here also, they remember the war against the Druhyus, where Mandhater, the Ikshvaku king, came to their help. And so together, the Anavas, the Pauravas, and Mandhater together managed to defeat the Druhyus, who were driven out westwards. Then in the Puranas, that are garbled, admittedly, but that nevertheless also do conserve a lot of really ancient, even pre-Vedic history, it is said in so many words, they went to the northwest and they set up kingdoms there. And so a number of cities, starting with Gandhara, which is still just in Pakistan, and then several successive cities in Afghanistan are named after Druhyu chieftains. And so this history is preserved in the Vedas. Then, far more vividly, far more in detail, you have a description of the Battle of the Ten Kings and the Varshagira battle two generations later, which are part of the war between the Vedic tribe and the Anava tribe, or the Proto-Iranians. And so there you get a description of, you know, this battle is fought on this river. You know, a few elements of the strategy are even given. And so the Proto-Iranians are defeated and they leave the country to Afghanistan, which becomes for a number of centuries the center of their civilization, which for instance is where Zarathustra lived. So two generations later you get another battle, the Varshagira battle, which is just across the Bolan Pass in Afghanistan. And there you have two versions. You have the Vedic version and you have the Avestan version. You see, this is unique. I mean, every historian should be very excited to find this. Such an ancient event of which you get two versions. And in fact, in this case, a war where both camps give their own version. And so this was a very important battle because this, one of the fighters on the Iranian side is Vishtaspa, or in Sanskrit, Ishtaspa, who is the of the Kavji dynasty, who is the royal patron of Zarathustra And so we know quite a few things that we can deduce from this. We know, for instance, everybody assumes that there was a Zoroastrian revolution, that Zarathustra himself effected some big reform. Now here we can see that this is not the case. Two generations earlier, you have the Battle of the Ten Kings, and there already those things that are deemed typical of the Zoroastrian reform are already in place. So Vasishtha describes the religion of the enemy. He says that they are anindra, they are without Indra, they are adeva, they are without the devas, and they are ayajna, they are without fire sacrifice, which is exactly true of Zoroastrianism. Why? Well, they also have fire, but they don't sacrifice into it. They don't throw things into it. They also throw no dead bodies into it. They have no cremation. Why? Because they consider fire so sacred that you can't pollute it by throwing things into it. Then you see all their names are Iranian. King Kavasha is a name that still appears among Parsis today. The tribes, you see the Parshus, Persians, the Pertus, the Parthians, the Pakhtas, the Pashtus, the Baluchis. So it is very obvious that these are the Iranians. It's only strange that none of the translators saw that. In fact, maybe we have to find out the detail about this because I can hardly believe it. But so at any rate, the translations never say anything about this. They say that the Iranians are the black aboriginals. Around the year 2000, there was a real debate. I already mentioned Hans Heinrich Hoch's paper in 1999. The great pioneer of this debate is Edwin Bryant, who wrote a PhD thesis about this in the year 2000. Then he started working together with Laurie Patton on editing a collection of papers called the Indo-Aryan Controversy, which would bring together papers in favor of the Aryan invasion and against it. I'm also in it, Talageri, Satyaswarup Mishra, but also Hans Hock, also Michael Witzel. So the only thing that strikes you is the inequality in status. You know, you get big time professor from Harvard like Michael Witzel, and then you get this motley crowd of out of India theorists like the bank clerk, Shrikant, Talageri, and you know. Well, yeah. Yeah, I mean, for history, you know, this is a cute anecdote, you know, this circumstance that, you know, we are just a bizarre little lot, totally unimportant, totally marginal, despised by their own society. And yeah, well, still they're going to be found wrong. Now, in the abstract of this collective volume, Bryant and Patton write, "The volume ends with a plea for a return to civility in the debates, which have become increasingly and unproductively politicized, and this volume suggests a program of research and inquiry upon which scholars from all sides of the debate might embark." Now, that I second. I think this is a very good suggestion. I'm all for it, except I'd like to update it. Much of this research that she proposes, or that they propose, has already been done. You've heard quite a bit of it today. Unfortunately, not everybody thinks so. And so the very influential Sanskritist Stephanie Jamieson, the one who made that, who co-authored that translation of the Rig Veda, she said in her review of this book, "The parallels between the intelligent design issue, that is to say Christian creationism, and the Indo-Aryan controversy are distressingly close. You know, she doesn't even want to call it a controversy, because in a controversy there are two parties. Whereas here you have science against nonsense. That's us. The Indo-Aryan controversy is a manufactured one with a non-scholarly agenda. And the tactics of its manufacturers are very close to those of the intelligent design proponents mentioned above. However unwittingly, and however high their aims, the two editors have sought to put a gloss of intellectual legitimacy with a sense that real scientific questions are being debated on what is essentially a religio-nationalistic attack on a scholarly concept. Well, I plead guilty as charged. Except that I have no religious nor nationalistic motive behind this, but I do attack the scholarly consensus, yes. Now, this statement is flatly untrue. First of all, many opponents of the Aryan invasion theory have no ideological dog in this fight. They have no ideological motive, starting with myself. I am neither a Hindu nor a nationalist. And so we had people like the American archaeologist Jim Shepherd, for example. We had a Parsi, K.D. Setana. Now, unless he converted, you know, I wouldn't call him a Hindu nationalist, and so on and so on. Now, typologically, the Out of India theory is just another homeland theory. You see, there has been, I mentioned a few, the North German homeland theory, the Anatolian homeland theory, the Belarusian homeland theory. You know, what's wrong with those? Are they crazy too? And then in this case, there is the circumstance, which doesn't even count for any of the other homeland theories, that for more than 60 years, it had been the number one homeland theory. That was the scholarly consensus. You know, she talks about a attack on a scholarly consensus. Well, that was the scholarly consensus. India is the homeland. But it must be said, on the other hand, that Hindus have made a number of mistakes. So, you see, I always have these quarrels with Hindus. But that's not at all because I disagree with the Hindu cause. In fact, if I quarrel with Hindus, it is because I want Hindus to win. And many Hindus are in it for something else than victory. Like, they want to get their kicks, you know, they want to, you know, get their emotional rocks off. Or they want to feel morally better. Yes. Like you say, oh yeah, you see, this is all a concoction by the ugly, vicious, racist, colonialist, which means also, oh, they are ugly, vicious, racist, colonialist, and I am not. So, you know, you don't have to make any effort to comprehend this whole issue, to contribute, you know, to our knowledge of this issue. No, superior. So, you know, there's a lot of, factors that spoil the whole issue. You know, the Hindu position is the correct one, but it's also, yeah, soiled a bit by these ulterior motives. And, you know, let's look at a few examples. Quite a few, also today, but already 20 years ago, pontificated that the Aryan invasion theory had been defeated, that nobody believes in it anymore. Well, you see, the arguments against it are accumulating. And back then already they were pretty serious. And I'd say that, yes, and in fact I did say at the time already, that the out of India scenario is the more likely one. Nevertheless, it's not true that the issue has been won, because those who have the power have not been won over. And, you know, if you want to win a battle, it is of the essence that you are supremely realistic. You see, if you are on an uphill battlefield where the enemy has a far more favorable position, then you should not say, that's not fair. You see, on a battlefield, that doesn't matter. You see, the reality is that he is in a better position than you are. You have to do better your best than he. You know, I mean, I see this on Twitter and so on all the time. Yeah, but why shouldn't we? You know, they do it, why shouldn't we? Well, because they have a good position, they can get away with all kinds of things that will be punished if you do it. So, they can, for example, afford to neglect, to ignore the opponent's position, but you can't. The Aryan evasion theory is all over the place. You run into it in the discourse of Prime Minister Modi, for example, who just a few days ago called the tribals Adivasis, just as Rahul Gandhi had done a few weeks ago. Okay, so that's the theory, that the Adivasis are the aboriginals, implying that all the others are not. That's a beautiful one-word disinformation campaign coined by the Christian missionaries in around 1920. The word Adivasi, which falsely suggests that it is a classical Sanskrit word, which proves that even the ancient Hindus already were aware that they were invaders, that they were squatting on somebody else's land. So you see, that ugly, dishonest word was being used in all seriousness by Prime Minister Modi, the supposed Hindu fanatic. So you have not won the debate. The other party still holds all the cards except for the arguments. And as Rajaram was among those who said that nobody believes in the Aryan invasion theory anymore, he also produced his own decipherment of the Harappa script, which alas went nowhere. He also, invented depictions of horses in Harappa. As you know, neither the cow nor the horse is ever depicted on the Harappa seals. Bulls are, but cows aren't. But so the horse isn't either. So he had not photoshopped, he was accused of having faked this. No, but you see, in good faith, he had completed the picture so that it looked like a horse. It's probably a buffalo that's depicted. And so this was mercilessly attacked in an article by Michael Witzel and Steve Farmer, published as a cover story in the communist fortnightly Frontline. And it was very humiliating. I mean, I asked myself, is he going to survive that? You know, many people would get a heart attack. Anyway, it also led to the total defeat of the Hindu parents in the California textbook affair. You see, there they wanted to change the picture given of Hinduism. And so they had prepared a number of improvements. And one of them was the claim that there is no Aryan evasion, that this theory has been discarded, which is simply not true. The theory may be wrong, but it has not been discarded. And so this alerted a number of professors, like the same Michael Witzel, and they approached the California Board of Education. The edits proposed by the Hindu parents were rejected. Then the Hindu parents went through some appeals procedure with the Board of Education. It was again rejected. Then they went to court, they lost the court case. Then they went to appeals court, they lost the court case. So it was the most complete defeat, and costing them $40,000. All you see as a consequence of a mistake that they made in their position in the Aryan invasion debate. In this case, I know them well. I followed the whole thing very closely because on the very first day I had warned them, if you do this, you're going to be defeated. And that's, alas, what happened. So there is a lot of pressure against the Out of India theory. So what Stephanie Jamieson said about that this is an unscientific, an anti-scientific theory, that was an explicit call to do that which has become a general policy of the Aryan invasion camp, namely contemptuous stonewalling of the Out of India theory. So since then we are treated as flat earthers on whom no breath or ink should be wasted. For example, I was present in Louvain-la-Neuve in Belgium at some academic ceremony where an award was given to the French Indologist Bernard Sergent. Just a week before that, a review had been published in a French paper of the French translation of Michel Danino's book, The Invasion That Never Was. And so Sergent remarked about this, yes, you see, I'm not going to read this book because I know it's not true anyway. And so that's the general attitude. They don't get to know the Out of India theory because they say beforehand it can't be true. Joanna Nichols is a scholar who was profusely quoted by Shrikant Talageri when she had shown that a number of loan words present in West Asian languages, loan words from Indo-European, and the pattern of distribution of these loan words show that the origin of those words was in the northeast, in Afghanistan. And so now, when her paper was republished, she added a note saying that she had first contributed a beautiful theory that accounts elegantly for a great deal of the dynamic and linguistic geography of the Indo-European spread, and that this here still stands. So this is a theory that shows how the Indo-European loans in West Asia indicate an Afghan provenance. But now she disowns the logical implication in favor of the Out of India theory of her own research that at the same time still stands. The same thing with Klaus Peter Zoller, who stands by his discovery of Proto-Bangani. This is a substrate. There's a number of words of older origin of outside the language which still exist in the dialect Bangani, spoken somewhere in the Himalaya. And so this shows that there was a Kentum language, that is a type of language that belongs to the European branches, to Celtic or Germanic. And that nevertheless was present in North India, which suggests, I won't say it proves, but it certainly suggests that these Western branches actually came from India. So he stands by this discovery, but he disowns its pro Out of India implications. Why is there this veto against the Out of India theory? Well, Shrikant Talageri makes fun of the radical damage control measures and weird about turns taken by the Aryan invasionists, such as the Stalin-era-like retraction by Nichols, just discussed, and he attributes all this to peer pressure. And so, yes, you see that pressure on scholars to conform is enormous. And so I remember at the time when I did not really carry that label of Out of India theorists, when I could still be saved, let's say, that you see a number of people, you know, like they said, Hans Heinrich Hock, for example, you know, in a paternal manner, talked into me, come on, you know, an intelligent man like you, how can you be swayed by these ridiculous, dangerous Hindu fanatics? And so, you know, that kind of pressure is enormous. And then once you hold out, once you remain firm, then they can become nasty. Yet, you see, to say, as many do in India, oh, this is because of racism. Now, that is totally anachronistic. It's just like after this BBC documentary against Modi, many people said, yeah, this is colonialism all over and so on. Now, that has just nothing to do with it. The people who now made that BBC documentary are not the colonialists of 100 years ago. You know, there is something that perhaps many in India have a hard time understanding. It is called change. You see, the Western culture has changed. It's no longer colonial. It's no longer racist. Racist used to be a very common thing, very commonplace, shared by everyone. Now, you see, maybe you can still secretly, if you're very careful, think racist thoughts, but nobody's going to say any such thing in public. And anyway, you see here, the racist motive has clearly been replaced by other ones. There is, first of all, the inertial clinging to the familiar. You can imagine, you know, a scholar has written a book on, let's say, the Upanishads. And so he says, yeah, it is said in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, brackets, 800 BC, that, this and that. But then later in the Shvetashvatara Upanishad, 400 BC, it is this and this. Now, if suddenly this Aryan invasion theory on which your dates are based, if that is no longer true, then maybe these dates are obsolete. Maybe now it's no longer Brihadaranyaka 800 BC, maybe this becomes 1400 BC, which is more or less what I think it is. And so you see, all these things look yellowed, look obsolete. And so, you know, better to keep everything like it is. Then, of course, you have the most important reason is the demonization of the out of India theory as Hindu nationalist. And so that's really bad. And we'll go see, you know, how far that is true. Then there is the factor of anti-racism. You see, some Hindus still live in the 19th century and talk about racism. The real problem now is anti-racism, also for the Hindus. Because what the whites are in America, namely the ugly, vicious, overbearing majority, that's what the Hindus are in India. The ugly, vicious, overbearing majority. And, you know, the minorities are the good guys, both in America and in India. And so, you see, if you think you can jump onto the woke bandwagon and be the good guy for once, well, I doubt that you'll have much success. Then there is the factor of hearsay. So most Western Indo-Europeanists don't know the out-of-India theory, don't know the circumstances in India. And you see, that itself is a consequence of the factors I just mentioned, also of something that you may hardly realize. It is the willful disinterest in questions of origin. You see, here, first of all, you have the fact that they know vaguely that there has for a long time been this search among Indo-Europeanists for the homeland, and that they've never gotten anywhere definitively. Because, you see, the Ukrainian homeland, that's more or less tolerated. Nobody wants to rock the boat. But actually, the evidence for that is not too strong either. But so nobody really cares. And so that's also because it is quaint. You see, in the Bible, you have all these genealogies. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and he was the father of Jacob, and so on. And in the Puranas, exactly the same. You know, you have Manu, who was the father of Ila, who was the father of Puravas. And so we are above that. You know, we don't ask people, what was your father? Was he rich? Was he poor? Was he nobility? Was he a Dalit? Or so, you see, it's not appreciated anymore. So that's also a reason why many in the West don't want to be interested in questions of origin, and why they find it bizarre that Indians apparently are so worked up about. Then finally, there is also the leftist rejection of any concept of a people. This is part of their anti-nationalist discourse. So the whole idea that there ever existed a people that spoke Proto-Indo-European, that also doesn't fit in their worldview. The famous theoretician of that position is Jean-Paul de Moule, there on the photograph. Now, is there really no racism anymore? Well, in German media, for historical reasons, of course, they keep any tinge of racism at a great distance. In France, you have the so-called Nouvelle Droite, which means the new right. That's not Nazi, but it certainly is Euro-nationalist. Like one of its ideologues was Jean Haudry, an Indo-Europeanist, but who recently died. Because of this European nationalism, they stand by the Aryan invasion theory. They're fairly open-minded. In a day of cancel culture, it is remarkable that with their pro-Aryan invasion position, they did allow me to write the case for the Out of India theory in their paper, which, however, they immediately answered with two counter papers, one by the editor and one by this Jean Haudry. Then you have, and he's quite present on YouTube, with a channel called Survive the Jive, the British historian Thomas Rousel, who is a neo-heathen, and he very much stands by the traditional version of the Aryan invasion theory. The picture you see there, that's from him. So that's really the Aryan invasion in the traditional imagery. You see, whereas many professors nowadays squeamishly say, oh, no, they came under the radar, they didn't invade anything. No, they took over India without you noticing. And that's now the official position. Whereas he proudly said, invasion. With horses and chariots, you see, because the Indians couldn't invent that, somebody had to bring it. Then in America, you have the Journal of Indo-European Studies. If you go back to its early days, I think it's 50 years ago, this was founded by Roger Pearson, and he is, according to leftists, or he was a racist and a friend of Hans Günther, whom I already mentioned as a racist ideologue. But he's long dead now, and so this is all a thing of the past. So in general, the political abuse of the Aryan invasion theory in the West is a thing of the past. And this also makes them rather insensitive to the situation in India. And they don't realize what enormous and enduring political role the Aryan invasion theory has played here. Nor do they therefore understand the reactive sympathy that the Hindutva parties have shown for the Out of India theory once it spontaneously came into being. So about the politicized Aryan invasion theory in India, you see, the well, we'll come to that first. We'll mention the position of the Hindu nationalists, which is also in favor of the Aryan invasion theory, at least if you go back to the beginning. Savarkar, in his book Hindutva, accepts the Aryan invasion theory. Why? Not because he was very much in favor of it, but because of the prestige of Western scholarship at the time. At that time, it was like very dominant, and it seemed futile to go against it. However, this was not important because, well, first of all, even if there is a political motive, it can still be correct. And so actually, all those scholars, and I could name a few, who have attacked us, claiming that we are political and motivated by Hindu nationalism and so on, they should absolutely be ashamed of themselves. You know, for a scholar, this is totally unbecoming that you consider the motives why somebody takes a certain position. That position can be correct. Now, if that position turns out not to be correct, then in the next move, you may start psychologizing, okay, why could he possibly have taken that wrong position? And then you may consider the motives. But you see, for deciding whether a position is correct or not, these motives are totally unimportant. Apart from being irrelevant, the consideration of Hindu nationalism as a factor behind the out of India theory is wrong. Because the first Indo nationalist accepted the Aryan invasion theory. Or in the case of Balagangadhara Tilak, even developed their own version of the Aryan invasion theory. You know, he said that the Aryans came from the Arctic and invaded India. And so he was part of a Brahmin casteist minority that bought into the idea that the Aryans were superior and that therefore they themselves were part of this superior class. But so Savarkar quite sanely thought these questions of origin inconsequential. After all, there are very many countries that have national pride and a myth of origin, but that do accept that they were invaders or immigrants. America is quite a nationalist nation, and yet they're very young. And many countries that are older, of which you don't know it, you don't see it, nevertheless, also they have a history of immigration. In Romania, there are very many statues and boulevards and so on named after Traianus, the Roman emperor, who conquered this territory and Romanized it. And so the Romanian nation is indebted to Emperor Traianus 1800 years ago. So you see that that's an invasion theory and they don't mind. And so for India also, there could have been an invasion and yet nothing. Like, for example, V.S. Agarwal, he was a famous art historian and quite a nationalist. Nevertheless, he was also a great Aryan invasion believer. Whereas, by contrast, it is the Aryan invasion camp that is not so sane and that, for instance, claims that if your ancestors weren't here 4,000 years ago, then you don't belong here. You see, some Indians weren't here 4,000 years ago, like the Parsis were here only 1,200 years. But that's yesterday. The Syrian Christians, likewise. The Tibetans are only just here. But even a group of so-called aboriginals, so-called Adivasis, you see, the Nagas in Nagaland, they are only there for about 1,000 years. By Indian standards, that's nothing. But even a proverbial group of aboriginals, the Mundas, to which the present president Draupadi Murmu belongs. Yes, he's a Santhal. Okay, now, this Gyaneshwar Chaube, geneticist, has shown that to the extent that genes have anything to say, the genes in this population point to an entry into India less than 4,000 years ago, about at the time of the supposed Aryan invasion. They come from Southeast Asia, and in their case, genes do have something to say. You see, if the Aryans came, it was a small population that somehow managed to impose its language on a far larger population. That is to say, most of the people today who speak an Indo-European language in India are not descendants of the Aryan invaders. So to take their genes and reconstruct those of the Aryan invaders is a very difficult thing to do. By contrast, when the Mundas came, well, nobody of the natives had an interest in becoming a Munda, in adopting their speech. You know, the Mundas were not like more advanced or so. They were also not more numerous. Like, you can adopt a language simply because everybody speaks it. Now, that's not the case here. They were also a small minority. So it follows that those who still speak Munda today are very probably straight descendants of the first Mundas who settled here. Okay? Now, what he finds in their genes is that they are invaders or immigrants of 3,000 to 4,000 years ago. Right? Now, are they not Indian because of this? Is anybody going to deny them the right to be an Indian? Well, of course not. It is only these silly Aryan invasion theorists who make an issue of the theory, the hypothesis that you people all, you know, have ancestors that 4,000 years ago lived outside India. You know, I mean, this is crazy. And yet this is what Rahul Gandhi and Mallukarjuna Kharge and so on do. This is what the Ambedkarites do, what the secularists do, what the Dravidians do, what the Christian missionaries make them do. And it's crazy, right? So, you see, Hindu sanity, that's the solution. So, yes, there you have him, a picture of Mallukarjuna Kharge, who said in Parliament that Aryans are un-Indian, that they don't belong in India. And recently, Rahul Gandhi, he, on his long walk, he came through a tribal belt and he said, no, no, you are not Vanavasis. I will never call you Vanavasis. You are Adivasis. And not knowing, I mean, he's not very well informed, that this is a 20th century missionary coinage. And the Dravidian secular and chauvinist and their secularist masters. Dr. Ambedkar opposed the Aryan invasion theory, but the movement that goes by his name nowadays very much espouses it. And therefore, you get the Hindu nationalist reaction of sympathizing with the out of India theory. Now, the secondary homeland, as I said, you see, this has become a very common and accepted, a widely accepted notion among the Indo-Europeanists that the so-called homeland, Russia, Ukraine, is actually only a secondary homeland. So some say, no, the real homeland was Anatolia. Others say it was in northern Iran. From a European viewpoint, this makes no difference. Because, you see, wherever they came from, they ended up in Ukraine, and then they staged an enormous invasion into Europe, which was a very dramatic and bloody affair. So if you insist that these people came from India, then, of course, you have to accept the moral burden that Indians abroad are not the nicest people to know. I don't know, but that's a consequence. So Europe definitely had an Aryan invasion. But what about India? There is no sign of such an Aryan invasion. and in fact, maybe they came from there. However, at that conference in Leiden, a very good conference, but that Indian element was practically not noticed by anyone. Of the 30 papers, there were three that mentioned Sanskrit. There was only one that mentioned the out of India theory in one sentence, and the next sentence was that it is not accepted by most scholars, which is a statement of fact. Nothing wrong with it. Then nowadays you have genetics, so I think it's very overrated. In India especially, you see, people think that this whole issue can be decided by genetic discoveries. No, it can't, because genes don't speak. I mean, archaeologists have had to learn long ago that pottery doesn't speak. Well, similarly, genes don't speak. You see, why do people in Australia speak English? Well, because they came from England, or most of them, you know, and once English was in place, then other people who came took over English. But so there is a clear biological link with England. Why in Jamaica do they speak English? Because they came from England? Or because in Africa they speak English? No, because they changed their language. And this is what human beings do, not really all the time, but quite frequently. And so the use of genetics is limited. Of course, to get a language from place A to place B, you had to have some migration. Because in those days, people could not take an internet course of Sanskrit to learn it at a distance. Okay, so there was some migration necessary, but it was not sufficient, because then after that, all kinds of things can happen. And so if you want to preserve your language within your community, you know, that requires certain political decisions. So all kinds of things are possible, and therefore the importance of genetics is less and less and less. So it's very overrated. At that same conference, there was someone speaking about the Semitic substrate in the Celtic or in the island Celtic languages. And so that's a linguistic theory that I also have studied somewhat. I think it's very exciting, the idea that there were Semitic loan words also in Germanic, but especially in Irish. So that can be explained because the Phoenicians from Lebanon, speaking a Semitic language, had colonized all the way up to the North Sea, all the way up to Hamburg thereabouts, and several places on the English and Irish coast. So that's where the Semitic substrate might come from. Now, you see, a number of important linguists have worked on this, have developed certain hypotheses about this. Now, over there was someone who was going to drop all this because of genetics. He said, oh no, but you see, I've heard that there's no Mediterranean gene among the Irish population. First of all, genetics is still a science in its infancy. So maybe now they don't find it, but later they will find it. That's one. But, you know, at any rate, if two sciences, linguistics and genetics, come to different conclusions, then you should not throw away the one because of the other. The scientific thing to do is to then, well, hold your horses and look a second time at the conclusions of both. Maybe one of the two is wrong, maybe both are wrong, or maybe, you know, some kind of amendment is possible that somehow harmonizes the two. I mean, in science, you have to be very careful and think twice before you take these rash conclusions. So you see, the fact that now everybody is being sacrificed, everything is being sacrificed to this new, you know, this new idol of genetics, I think that is wrong. Anyway, I find that in India, Hindus are very, very enamored of this genetics because it's a hard science. Is it linguistics? Of course, nobody does in India, or hardly anyone. I have been a guest professor in an Indian university, and normally they can't hire any foreigner except if you can show that you've looked everywhere and that you couldn't find any Indian who could do this job. So I was enrolled as professor of Indo-European studies, and effectively there's no university in India that teaches this. So you see, this Indo-European linguistics is not taken seriously in India. There's practically nobody who does it. And, you know, Hindus have been getting by just fine without it. Maybe it's not so important. But at any rate, in archaeology, they're doing a lot better. And so the argumentation in archaeology against the Aryan invasion theory is a lot more serious, a lot more solid. And now that genetics has come, now that is really a hard science. And so, you know, all these Hindu engineers and so on are very enthusiastic about this. So, okay, I mean, you know, okay, let them. Now, one thing that genetics has found, and you heard it here today from Premendraji, is that the animals show interesting genetic patterns, so that clearly the zebus have emigrated from India. You see, this is something that zebus won't do spontaneously, because to get out of India, you have to climb all over the Hindu Kush mountains, and cows are like, you know, maybe goats can do it, but cows stay in the plain with very, you know, heavy soil and this fat grass and so on, and that's where they stay. And if there's no human being with a stick beating them and chasing them up the mountain, they will never go up the mountain. And so, you see, if the genes of Indian cows are found in Ukraine and in Syria and in Italy, then it's because humans have brought them there. So it's very certain that human beings have migrated from India. Now, whether they took the Indo-European languages with them, that is not a subject for genetics. That will then have to be figured out with other evidence. But at least, you see, this evidence is very useful and is very good to counter the story that genetics has, on the contrary, proven the Aryan invasion. Is there a symmetry between the two camps? You see, both the out of India theory and the Aryan invasion theory accuse each other of being concoctions. You see, here in India, I hear all the time, oh yeah, the Aryan invasion theory was concocted by the British colonizers. And, you know, in Europe, I hear all the time, yeah, but you see, the out of India theory was concocted by the Hindu nationalists. You see, I really wonder if they know what they're saying. You see, what they're saying is, okay, one day you see this parliamentarian comes home from his work in parliament and he's still unhappy about what the other guy said. He said, how am I going to fool them all? Eureka! I found it, you see. I'm going to launch a scholarly theory so good that even the specialists of that discipline are going to buy into it and are going to propagate my little theory. Now, I mean, come on, you see, what a conspiracy theory is this. You see, this is not how things are done. You know, these two theories were not concocted. Moreover, I know they weren't concocted because I know how they really came about. And so, you see, drop this story. You know, nothing is gained with it. Now, you, of course, may start by dropping the story. That doesn't necessarily entail that the other guys are also going to drop their story. That may take a little longer. But, you know, you can start by, you know, sanitizing this debate by dropping these sob stories. Then, on Twitter, you see all the time all these pro out of India trolls who dismiss all the, you know, who dismiss Michael Witzel and Hans Hock and so on, they're not worthy of consideration. That's in very many debates, that's an attitude that Hindus take. You know, the BBC says, yeah, but who cares about the BBC? Well, come on, you know, the BBC has power. You know, if you are not going to be concerned with the BBC, I'm afraid that the BBC is going to be concerned with you. So, this haughty attitude is misplaced. But anyway, it is not the mirror image of the attitude on the other side. You see, there also exists such a haughty attitude, but there it is not so much among Twitter trolls, it is among the authorities, like Professor Stephanie Jameson, who calls for a boycott of the position that we are here now defending. So actually, at this moment, since about 16, 17 years, any attempt to answer the out-of-India theory and defend the Aryan invasion theory has become non-existent. In Aryan invasion circles, the Aryan invasion is treated as proven, just as Rajaram used to treat it as disproven. Okay? So it's like it's no longer up for debate, it's proven. And so the main result is that, you know, after some years of this situation, nobody has studied the out-of-India theory anymore, and so very few people really know what it's about. Now, what to do about this, I hardly know. You see, you have to find ways to resume the talk. Now, this is actually possible. I mean, at those conferences in Oxford, in Leiden, and in Berlin, I talked to quite a few people, and quite a few people are quite open to the out-of-India theory, only they're not interested. You see, they have this attitude that is all a quaint thing, a discussion from the past, that they don't really want to waste time on. But quite a few people are open to it. And so, if more of you talk to them, I think that will make a difference. Now, the fact that they don't show any curiosity about what is really the main contender for their own theory at the moment. I mean, the Anatolian theory, that's a bit, that was 90s. Then the Iranian theory of David Reich, still marginal. Maybe it's something to take into account in the future. But actually, the real challenger is the out-of-India theory. And they don't show any interest in this. You see, for scholars, I find that rather weak, that you have this challenge to your paradigm and you ignore it. You know, that's the situation. And so for Hindus, I would say, well, yeah, you see, there's all kinds of things that the others do wrong, but what have you done wrong? You know, think about that carefully. However, maybe you need not do anything. You see, there are many Hindu problems that get solved somehow. And so I think, you know, in moments when I'm not too rational, when I'm not, you know, animated by the scientific temper, then I wonder, you know, maybe if you do yajñas and pujas, you know, maybe that creates so much good vibration that Indra up there and Varuna and Saraswati and so on, that they will come to your side, that they will help you, and that suddenly, without having done anything, you find that suddenly all your wishes are fulfilled. So maybe that is going to happen. I hope so. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Elst. I'll ask you the first question. So I was observing this very interesting argument that you were having on Twitter with somebody who was talking about the Sinoli war chariots not being horse-driven, and even saying S.K. Manjul said that, which is totally wrong. And secondly, what about the astronomical or astro-archaeological data which even supports the OIT?
Yes. Well, about Sonori, I can't say I'm an expert. At this archaeological conference in Gandhinagar last week, I noticed that even among archaeologists, there were serious differences of opinion, especially about Sonori. And so, you see, the theory that the out-of-India theorists have seized upon, that is really the dominant theory. That's what most archaeologists think, as far as I can see. So they think this is the first horse-drawn chariot in the world that we have discovered so far. You know, far more than in Sintashta in Russia, which according to Alexander Semenenko is not even a horse-drawn chariot at all. But so, you know, there are also others who think, no, you see, this is not even an Harappan site. This was a different culture, which may be influenced by Harappa, but it was not Harappan. Now, I saw other archaeologists laugh at this position, saying, no, of course, this is Harappan. Now, here you see, I don't know. I noticed that the professionals haven't resolved the matter yet, and I can't do it in their place. Then, as for the astronomical evidence, well, you know, that is extremely important evidence. And so, you see, all the outsiders who ignore this, well, do so only at their own peril. You know, I mean, you know, sometimes I am impatient with Hindus for taking certain evidence not into account, but the same thing counts for the other camp. You know, I mean, if I say Hindus are wrong here and here and here, it's not a very anti-Hindu position because, you know, on other occasions I'll have to say the same thing for Westerners, for instance. But nevertheless, some history rewriters are very, very, very full of the astronomical argument, but they take it too far, and also they're often just simply wrong. Like, for example, I hear many Hindus who take the four world ages serious, who talk about, oh yeah, but this happened in Dwapara Yuga. Now, I mean, here I can't help laughing, sorry. You see, originally, the four world ages existed in Indo-European, I won't say mythology, in the Indo-European worldview. And that was not linked to any specific date. You know, in Germanic mythology, you have the spear age, the sword age, the wind age, and the wolf age. And similarly, in Greece, you have the Golden Age, the Silver Age, the Bronze Age, and the Iron Age. And that's never linked to any specific duration. And the same was the case in India. Now, Yuga in itself means a conjunction of two planets, or the cycle from one conjunction to the next conjunction. So in the case of sun and moon, it's a month from new moon to new moon. It can mean any cycle. And so the first cycle that was used, I think you said it also before, is a 5-year cycle. Why? Because the lunar year is not exactly the same as the solar year. It's 11 days short, as you can see in the Islamic calendar. And so in most calendars, the Islamic calendar being the exception, you add an extra month, a 13th month, whenever necessary. So ultimately it turns out that this is seven times per 19 years. That's the best approximation. But an earlier, simpler, but less precise approximation was 5 years. If you add two extra lunar months, then after 5 years, you end up on the same date as the solar new year. So the first yuga is 5 years. Then 19 years is the next yuga, or first 8 years. That's also an approximation where you add three lunar months. Then you have 19 where you add seven of them. And so on. Now, the longest cycle in astronomy was the 20-year cycle of Jupiter-Saturn, or the 60-year cycle of Jupiter-Saturn together with a specific star in the zodiac. Then in 127 BC in Alexandria, Hipparchos of Nicaea discovered the precession movement. Now, the precession movement is a very large cycle of 25,772 years. And so this was rounded off in the beginning to 24,000 years, which is twice 12,000 years. And so these 12,000 years were then used to put the four ages on, because they thought, oh, this is really cosmic. This is the biggest cycle that we've ever heard of. So in a proportion of 1, 2, 3, 4, these were put onto it. So 1,200 years for Kali Yuga, 2,400 for Dwapara, 3,600 Treta, and 4,800 Krta, and altogether 12,000. That system is attributed to sage Markandeya. Then it was multiplied by 360. You see, in the Puranas, everything becomes suddenly big. You know, like what you write in the Vedas, the rishis pray to become 100 years. That's already very long for them. Whereas in the Puranas, effortlessly, you know, Vishwamitra spends 1,000 years of tapas. And so here also, you see these 1,200 years suddenly become 432,000 years because they have been multiplied by 360. So out of awe for everything heavenly, they decide that a whole year for human beings is only a day for the gods. So that's why you have this multiplication. And so then you get these completely unwieldy numbers for the yugas, 432 years. And so then you get the idea, for example, since Rama was the Treta Kalthakur, and Krishna's death marked the end of the Dwapara Yuga, therefore, Rama must have lived at least 2 times 432,000 years before Krishna. So Rama lived 1,000,000 years ago. And so you see, that's mistaken. And so many of these history rewriters are totally dead serious about this. And they're, of course, dead serious about the Mahabharata war being in the 32nd century BC. But you see, that's all. You see, that idea of a fixed duration for the yugas, that only pops up in about the year 500 AD. It's not older than that. It is a classic example of what the English Marxist historian Eric Hobsbawm used to call an invented tradition. A tradition that falsely claims to be much older than it really is. Other examples are the idea that the Vedas are divinely revealed. The Vedic rishis didn't know anything about this. This is an idea invented clearly after the completion of the Vedic corpus. Or a more consequential example, the caste system. In the Vedas, there is no caste. And caste gradually comes into being. And so in history, in certain episodes, you can see the successive stages of the caste system until by about 200 AD, the whole Hindu society is divided in box-type jatis, which originally did not exist. And so people like the Puri Shankaracharya, who insist that this is intrinsic to Hinduism, that this is eternal, this is Sanatana and so on, well, they are selling you an invented tradition. And so, you see, that's the problem with archaeoastronomy as it is practiced in India. So, essentially, astronomy is right, it has the answers, and so it is a very important reason why we can say the Vedas are from beyond 3000 BC, but there's also a lot of nonsense, and that gives a bad name to the whole enterprise. You know, like Steve Farmer, a very militant Aryan invasion theorist, used to make fun of the Indian use of archaeoastronomy, understandably. But so, you see, in this case, when it comes to the chronology of the Vedas, archaeoastronomy is completely in harmony with other factors like archaeology. You see, what has archaeology found? Well, for example, the Sanauli that you mentioned, okay, you see these horse-drawn chariots, are not mentioned in the Rig Veda. There are carts, but not these horse-drawn spoke-wheel chariots. They appear in the 10th book, which is about the same time as the Sinology chariot. Then you have the desiccation of the Saraswati. So in the Rig Veda, the Saraswati is still a flowing river going to the ocean and so on. In 1900 BC, this dries up. So you see, that coincides with the end of the Rig Veda. So you see, a number of different factors, different astronomical factors also, all converge. This is totally in harmony. You see, a problem would arise if, for instance, the Rig Veda is said to be at a specific date because of stellar positions. It's like, say, you know, 2000 BC, and the Chandogya Upanishad, which is much younger, turns out to have stellar positions of 7000 BC. Now, there you would know, oh, here there's something wrong. But that never happens. You see, the whole corpus of astronomical indications is totally coherent and is totally against the Aryan invasion theory. There is not one astronomical position that supports Max Müller's chronology.
Thank you, Dr. Quinn, Dr. Elst, for your talk and for enlightening us. You begin with and end with the concoction theory. But then the missionaries have had a huge role in this. You yourself have alluded to this. And the European history, besides the Islamic history also, many such as all the Muslim historians of the early 10th century, 9th century, 8th century, they give the same Japhetian or Ham or Sam kind of lineages to different races. And as we all know, the European Padre from Seville, he issued a dictate in 7th or 8th century from Seville that Japhet is the... And there it goes. And then they locate Japhet either in Don or along Ural River or along Volga. So that is their boundary of Japhet. Yes, that's mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
And that is precisely the Pontic step. So how do we negate this? Because they are precisely following whatever has been taught, and then now they are pushing it. You can call it concoction, you can call it bias, you can call it whatever, colonialism or racism. But then that has been inbuilt, ingrained, and they are pushing it. And now we have to accept that it is a concoction, because you yourself say that they dismiss any counter argument. So they have built their position, they don't want to budge out of it, and it's a biased one.
No, I don't think they dismiss any counter position. They mostly ignore any counter position. There are a few, yes. I are given their names on the way. But the Japhet story, for instance, I think nobody believes that anymore. That's 18th century. Then the other thing, I mean, like, for instance, a key role was played by this British Jesuit in the 16th century, by this French Jesuit in the 18th century. And yet, this was not a Christian concoction. They did good scholarship. They very correctly, you know, saw the relation between Latin, Greek, and Sanskrit. They were simply right. And if they perhaps also had Christian motives, there's no indication of that. But okay, well, in that case, they're still right. So you see, whatever these motives are, again, you can ask the question after you found them wrong. You see, if now you can show that Gaston Laurent Curdoux was wrong in positing Indo-European kinship, then you can ask, okay, why would he, you know, claim this wrong theory? Yeah, maybe he had an ulterior motive. But right now, you see, there is no reason for asking this question. And so, no, the Christian missionaries, for example, and the Dravidianists and so on, they very much used the Aryan invasion theory. They didn't concoct the Aryan invasion theory. It was already there. And then they saw, oh yeah, we can use it.
This is about the movement of cattle. So this is in the nature of a suspicion, not an objection. The movement of westward movement of cattle seems to mirror the eastward movement of the horse. So it seems to play the same part in the OIT as the horse plays in the AIT. Can't we just accept that we exported cattle and imported horses and didn't have to go through a migration or invasion for this?
Yeah, that's a possibility, of course. Yes, so horses were imported into India. You know, there was a horse trade going on. And so in many episodes in history of horse traders, like the Portuguese in India, you know, this one of the big things they did was import horses. So yeah, that's not impossible. Although, you see, the enormous success of these horses is special, of these cows. And moreover, the fact that they, like, precisely correspond to the movement of human beings as per languages. You see, there where the Mitanni go, you see, there the cows go. They don't go to China. You see, the Indo-Europeans from India have never gone to China, and neither have their cows. But they have gone westwards, and so have the cows. So, yeah, I mean, in theory, I mean, and this is healthy to try out all the alternative explanations. But so I don't think in this case it is strong enough to seriously doubt the conclusions by, for instance, Dr. Peri-Caucasian. Yes?
Exporting of horses, there are literary evidences, like the KKR King Ashwapati is actually mentioned as the lord of the horses. And there is an Ashwatirtha in Varanasi, where the horses are brought in from the same KKR region and distributed to the kings. So that is a literally available kind of situation where the horses are brought from areas like Gandhara or any western area to the Indo-Gangetic plain. Whereas for the cattle, we don't have any literally evidence for export.
Okay. Yes, doctor?
Out to speak a few words on it. Actually, in Rig Veda, there is mention of herds of wild horses on the banks of the thousands and thousands of wild horses grazing on the banks of the Saraswati. So to think that India didn't have horse and they imported is not correct. But they became extinct once that area became a wetland after 5,500 years due to the shift of the monsoon. And the horses will die in any forest because they don't have speed to run, and they will be devoured by the tigers and other animals. That's why they became less and less. Yet in the forests like Himachal Pradesh or in Kashmir or in Manipur, Nepal, Indian horse survived, which is smaller in size, and it is called Indian village horse. It is still there, not very high. It is almost this size. We can ride, climb on it easily. So we have to look on the origin of horse and its persistence in India from different evidence also. Thank you.
Thank you. Horses have been mentioned in Pushkar around 4,000-5,000 BC era. Horses have been shown in cave paintings, and they are again in the period of 2,000-3,000 BC in multiple cave paintings throughout Vindhyas.
Mm-hmm.
Throughout Vindhyas. And Dr. Saab has rightly pointed out that India had two sources of horses. One is Central Asia, Central Asia and Arabia, of course. Then India had an indigenous one in Jodhpur region, Marwari and Kutchi horses, and definitely a Turk, Tibetan Turk variety.
Mm-hmm.
And they are very frequently mentioned again in different chroniclers, wherein these Nepal and Tibet, they are source of those horses. So, and now horse thing, of course, has been proved a hole in that AIT theory, of course.
Mm-hmm.
You can take from that.
This is a few that I don't know much about, so thanks.
I had a question about, you talked about how genes don't speak, right? So I wanted to just propose the idea of drawing the arrows with genetics and then using biolinguistics to then draw the arrows. So what is your opinion on that? So minor syntax changes in linguistic structure can possibly predict the direction of migration. What would be your opinion on that?
Of course, languages change all the time, whether in isolation or in contact with others. So I maybe I don't understand, but I don't see what this adds to our knowledge. I mean, of course, we know that all the time languages change, whether through influence by others or through their own internal evolution.
There's a confusion, because the linguistic migration paths and language migration path need not always be the same.
Of course, I think I've said that myself. Of course, they need not be the same. No.
Sure.
So, you see, the whole idea of a linguistic argument for the homeland is very vulnerable, let's say. In some respects, you might have found an answer which just happens not to be there. For example, the Bantu languages in Africa, they come from the northwest of Black Africa, so south of the Sahara, and they are linked with a number of related languages in that region. And that specific group, Bantu, has then started expanding, mostly because they started practicing agriculture, that expanded all the way to South Africa, to the Cape. Now, if you look at the two ends of this language family, in one, it is all by itself, surrounded by non-related languages, like the Khoisan languages, with the click sounds. And on the other hand, you have a lot of related languages. And so you can see all these languages has to come from there and not from there, right? Now, in the case of a European, you happen not to have that. You see, in Europe, Basque or Uralic are not specifically related to Indo-European, and certainly not in a way that can allow you to pinpoint a locus where it must have happened. In fact, there are no surviving European languages, none. You see, Basque comes from Northwest Caucasus, Uralic comes from Siberia, and Indo-European, well, that's, the jury is still out on that. You see, at most, it comes from the far southeastern corner of Europe, or it comes from outside of Europe. But so it can't be related to any European language because there is no European language. They're all immigrant, right? And so to anchor them into Europe, it would have been useful if it could have been shown to have exchanged words at its earliest stage with some European language. But that hasn't happened because that could not happen. Now, has the same thing happened in Asia? And everybody assumes that is not the case. Now, here I have recent work by Igor Tonoyan Belyayev from St. Petersburg. And so he argues that a number of words have been borrowed from Tibetan. Like, for instance, the word pugs in Tibetan means cattle, is related to a Proto-Indo-European root that you find almost literally in faraway Latin in the form pecus, which means cattle, and where from the word pecunia, which means money, because, you know, cattle was also used as a form of currency. Now this pecus also exists in Sanskrit, pashu. Pashu is derived from it, but pashu has gone through a typical sound shift that is typical for the Indo-Aryan languages, so pecus becomes pashu. Now what you find in Tibetan is a word that is clearly not related to pashu, because of course there are many Sanskrit loans in Tibetan, but they are not what interests us. We want to go back to the earlier stage of Proto-Indo-European. So there we see that pecus and pukes are the same word. So you see, and there are a few, there are only a handful. Although maybe if you look harder, you will find more. There is also the limitation that the time between the first, the oldest Tibetan that we know and Proto-Indo-European is also more than 4,000 years. So who knows to what extent Tibetan has changed in the meantime. So this is all very, you know, question mark. Nevertheless, if it is correct, you know, it's very important because it shows that the homeland was a neighbor to Tibetan, which will not be the case in Ukraine. Yeah, you see, there are some very, very few respects in which linguistics might give the answer, but mostly not. And linguists also admit this. And this is said point blank in books about, you know, handbooks of Indo-European linguistics, that linguistics can't find the answer. I myself learned in my university course of Indo-European linguistics that linguistics can't decide it, but fortunately, archaeology has decided it. And then the professor referred to B.B. Lal's work, where, you know, B.B. Lal had discovered the painted gray ware, which coincides with the Mahabharata cities. And so he had identified this as the Aryan invaders on their way deeper into India. And so for a very long time, that was the only archaeological proof for the Aryan invasion. And then later he saw, well, you see, I was a young man. I was very much under the wing of Mortimer Wheeler. I couldn't think otherwise than of fitting it into the reigning paradigm, which is the Aryan invasion. But now when I look back on it, it doesn't prove that paradigm. It, you know, I myself have fitted it into the paradigm, but it might have harmonized with another paradigm also. And it is not a proof of the Aryan invasion. So the only archaeological proof that ever existed fell away. And so if you have to count only on the linguistic proof, it is very meager. And one example that Hans Hock has tried is the isoglosses. Now here this is pretty technical, but so what it means is that some branches of Indo-European, but not others, have a common linguistic history. They have gone through certain changes which bind them together, but which separate them from other branches. Okay? Now, as Talageri has shown, some very good examples of this can be found between Indo-Aryan, Iranian, Armenian, Greek, Albanian. And like, for example, you have the augment, which means an additional e, or in Sanskrit a, to mark the past tense of a verb. This does not exist in Germanic, Celtic, and so on, but it does exist in Greek, it does exist in Sanskrit. So you see that these southern languages, this whole belt from Greek to Sanskrit, have a certain common history that they don't share with the other languages. So after Germanic, Slavic, and so on had split off, these languages were still together. And that's exactly what you find in the Rig Veda, where the Anavas are the ancestors of the Iranians, but also the Greeks, the Armenians. And so, you see, that's one consistent belt, you know, that remained together until finally they went far enough to lose contact with each other. So that's a possible linguistic argument. Again, I wouldn't call it proof. This is a word that is used far too easily. But okay, it would be an indication, a weak indication. But to the extent that it is an indication, it supports the out of India theory more than the Aryan invasion theory. So you see, this way you can accumulate the arguments. But so I think in this case, the archaeological arguments that we, and genetic arguments that we've recently heard are a bit more decisive than those linguistic arguments. You see, the linguistics is important to just define the group, to really be able to say Sanskrit is more related to Latin than to Tamil. That much is solid. But then you see, to use it to determine the Urheimat, the homeland, that's not a great success so far. And in fact, you know, for 250 years, you know, they've been looking for it and they still haven't found it. And so now, to a large extent, they thought, oh, we have found it. It is in Ukraine. And now even that is being questioned again. So, you know, I wouldn't dismiss the linguistic evidence, but, you know, put it between brackets.
I just had a curiosity. Do we find any evidence of any literature? If let's assume the Aryan invasion theory and be the devil's advocate, I would imagine that in the wherever they came from, there should be something as profound as the Vedas there. How come there is nothing there? Is it that the Aryans didn't have any philosophy and they came to India and they became enlightened? I find this very hard to believe that, and then the whatever the Vedas have also evolved over time. You see nothing of that sort in Europe.
Well, you could explain it in invasionist terms. You could say yes, they were barbarians. Then they came into India, and there they learned from the natives. And so somehow, on the one hand, they took all the wisdom from the natives. On the other, they pushed upon the natives their language. That's the dominant scenario. So, you know, they had it all from the natives. And then, you know, I mean, you have an entire history of India that's based on this paradigm. Like they say, for instance, yeah, you see, Buddhism was a revolt of the natives against the dominant Brahminical culture of the invaders. And you can explain everything in those terms.
Regarding the answer you gave him, precisely this scenario occurred with Akkadian and Sumerian. Because Akkadians had invaded the area of Sumeria and Akkadian being an elite language just took over. So this is not impossible, but it did preserve all the wisdom of Sumer, and that's how you get the wisdom of the story of Gilgamesh and everything.
Yeah.
So this is not an unlikely scenario at all.
Okay, well, good, yes. Yes, of course. You see, there is in principle nothing impossible about the Aryan invasions theory. Only it happens not to be supported by the evidence.